Last time at the end of the lecture, we've briefly mentioned that there is this thing that's called exciton, and that I prefer the definition that can be found in the Feynman lectures on physics, that it is an excited state, which is neutral, and its energy can move. What we'll do today, we'll start by classifying different types of excitons. Or if you like, we'll start by calling them names, so we know what we are dealing with. So the first classification to discuss is the one that we find largely in inorganic literature, where we have two types of excitons. One which is tightly bound, and the distance between the electron and the hole is very small. And the other one is where the distance is large. One is localized, the other one is delocalized. And the two are typically found in different materials. The localized exciton would be in materials which don't have that many electrons. To screen the attraction between the electron and hole. This is why we call them dilute materials, and they would be low refractive index materials. And these, on the other hand, would have a high density of electrons. You would have a high optical density usually, and a high refractive index. However, we are interested in organic molecules or polymers, and we have discussed this neutral state where we have a molecule that is being excited. So almost by definitions, the excitons in organic materials or molecular materials would be tightly bound or Frenkel-type excitons. And what we've seen so far is the excitation of a molecule from its ground state to its excited state. And we'll see how we can further classify these excitons in organic materials too. So if you like what we've discussed a minute ago is the exciton, or the neutral excitation that is residing on a single chain. And if we would present these chains as quantum wells, then this is the picture. We have two chains, and the excitation is entirely on one of them. There are also instances where there is some coupling between the chains, and the electrons and holes would be distributed between them. Usually there would be some kind of asymmetry, so the electron and hole would be separated slightly in space. The quantum well equivalent would be the one shown here, where we have these lower lying levels with the electrons and holes residing a little bit in different spatial positions. And as I said, this situation requires some kind of a chain coupling, so the chains need to be relatively close to each other. And these two types of scenarios, we can classify them as the intra-chain exciton or the inter-chain exciton. The other type, or third type if you like, that could exist is if the molecules are not coupled but still a charge transfer between one to the other. And we may ask ourselves if this could be considered as an exciton too. If yes, how would you call it? Where would you see it? Etc. So that was one type of classification. The other one we'll be aiming for, we can think of it by comparing optical and electrical excitations. So let's start with electrical excitation. Let's assume we have injected the electron from one contact. We'll introduce the hole from the other contact, and then it starts to drift towards the other charge until finally they find themselves together on the same chain. And this really looks like what we've seen before for the optical excitation. And the question is, are these two necessarily the same or not? So we look at it from a different point of view. We have here the molecule that we are going to optically excite. We have here the molecule that is going to accept a charge from far, far away. And this is the optical excitation. And if we'll bring this charge to this molecule, then clearly the two are identical and we haven't really gained any extra classification. However, since this extra electron was injected from a contact far, far away, the spin is not necessarily have to be correlated with the one here, and we could find ourselves in a situation where the spins are the same or the sum of them is non-zero. So now we have two types of exciton. One type, the sum of the spin is zero. The other type, the sum is non-zero. The two of them have been named as a triplet and a singlet. Of course, the name has some meaning and we'll briefly discuss. So we are discussing particles that have spins. This is the total spins possessing around a given axis, which would be defined by the measurements that we might be doing. M is the projection on that axis. And we know that M could assume the values of plus or minus half. Plus would represent a spin up and minus would represent a spin down. Usually we take it for granted that the two of them are spinning at the same speed. The phase between them is locked. We're not going to discuss the situation where it's not fully locked and there is some phase shift that's being accumulated in time, but this could be an interesting case that we are not going to talk about. So why we have this name of triplet and singlet? So we know that we are combining two particles. And if we have a combination of plus minus half of two particles, then we will have one, zero, and minus one. And of course, these two are clearly, the one and the minus one are clearly for a spin that is not zero. So we have two states here. For m equals zero, we have what we would think of as the singlet, where the total spin, not only the projection, is cancelled. And there is also another situation where the total spin is non-zero, but the projection on the axis cancels out. So we see that we have three possibilities to assemble an exciton that has a spin larger than zero, and only one with s equals zero, and hence the names the singlet and the triplet. If we put all the three combinations of spin defining the triplet states, then we have the m equal one. You see the spins are up. M equal minus one, the spins are both are down. And m equals zero, the spin is pointing up and the other one pointing down, but you can see that the sum of them is non-zero, only the projection is zero. So why is this classification important? Well, triplets are important in many contexts, largely in biology or in pharmaceutical application. But in our case, we would think more at the moment in the context of light emission, and we would be interested if all of them or the two of them could emit light spontaneously. So we'll look at these two types of singlet and triplet. And you could see that Bob's fog is already giving us a hint that this one is going to be an emissive exciton, and this one is going to be quite dark. And the reason is that the spin here is not really adequate for the electron to relax and occupy this level. So there has to be some kind of a spin flip in the middle, which would require someone to interfere in the process, and that really reduces the chances for the event to be radiative. If we are thinking of the exciton as a combination of a electron and hole, or two molecules that reacted to form the exciton, then this is the combination for a singlet exciton, and similarly we have a combination for a triplet exciton. And you'll see that I've shifted the molecule with more energy slightly up to denote and or to emphasize the fact that this molecule carries more energy than this one. So as I've said, light emission is not the mechanism that would cause a spin flip. So a pure triplet state would not emit light. And as I said, we'd be interested in the effect on the light emitting diodes. So we, of course, we'll need to know a bit more about what's happening in a light emitting diode and how excitons are being generated. But for now, just to get a feeling, you can simply write the rate equation describing the transfer from the initial state of two charges on two molecules to the final states where both of them reside on one. And you'll be surprised, you know, which ingredients are supposed to be there. And if you look at them, you'll start getting a notion of how these triplets may affect the efficiency of such light emitting diodes. So really, we've classified the excitons, or if you like, we've called them, we've named them. And now we are into the motion of these excitons, singlets or triplets. And the question is, how do they move? So really what we're going to examine is the situation where we have a molecule which is in the excited state. And we want to see how it would move inside the film. And since it's neutral, it's more likely that we would be discussing a diffusion process. So the first one is trivial, and it is indeed trivial. We are thinking of an emission and absorption event. So we have one molecule, the donor, which relaxes and emits a photon. This photon travels in space and hits the acceptor molecule, and the acceptor is then being excited. Compared to the other processes that we haven't discussed so far, this one becomes effective at distances much larger than 10 nanometer between single molecules. And of course, because this is an emission and absorption event, then we know that several things need to be fulfilled. And the first one is that the donor should be able to emit light before it decays away, so the quantum efficiency should be high. There should be ability to hit the acceptor, so there should be a large one of them, large number of them, and the cross section should be sufficient that the photon would definitely hit one of the molecules. And lastly, the molecule has to be the acceptor molecule has to be such that it can really catch the light. And that requires the spectral overlap, which we write it as an overlap between the emission spectrum and absorption spectrum. And the top bar implies that the two of them has to be normalized. And this is the normalization procedure that we will employ, and it's usually the one that's being used. So we've talked about the trivial one that involves the radiation or emission of a photon. And the next rates we will discuss are radiation less. So we still are going to see a transfer from an excited donor to an excited acceptor. But this case, we are going to examine different types of coupling mechanisms. And of course, this, like many other things, could be described through the Fermi golden rule, where we look at the coupling between the initial and final states for the respective Hamiltonian, and we multiply it by the density of states of the final state. So really, this is our problem or challenge, going from this initial state to this final state. The first mechanism that we will discuss is named after Foster, and it is a mechanism by which singlet excitons can transfer their energy. And basically, this can be described in the context of dipole-dipole interactions, where each dipole could be described as 1 over r cubed, and hence the efficiency or the coupling would decay as a function of r to the 6. Typically, we use the decay rate or the spontaneous emission lifetime as a reference, and hence we would define r0 accordingly, so we know that when the two molecules are at a distance r0 between the two, then the rate of energy transfer is equivalent to the rate of emission. So basically, what we are considering is a Coulomb interaction between two molecules or two dipoles. And when they are in resonant and the two dipoles are similar, then the energy could bounce back and forth between the two of them. And this is actually the mechanism by which excitons can diffuse within the film. The work by Foster was derived using quantum arguments, but some years later it was shown that one could also use some classical descriptions, which are rather powerful and useful to describe different types of scenarios. So if we just look at the classical description of energy transfer. So basically, we are interested at the rate at which energy is being absorbed in the target molecule. And this could be represented using Ohm's law and the Poynting theorem. And we know that the energy being delivered by the dipole that is donating the energy is described by E square. This is the conductivity of the absorbing molecule. And if we assume the two of them are point dipoles, then we know how to describe the two quantities, the function of the dipole moment, the dielectric constant of the medium, etc. And if we plug the two of them together, then we can derive the transfer rate, which assumes this kind of relation, and the R0 in the classical derivation is composed this way. So basically, what we have is a dipole that emits light, its energy is decaying as R to the 6, and it's being absorbed by another point dipole. The other mechanism is an exchange mechanism. It is really a transfer of charges between the two molecules. If before there was only energy being transferred, here there is an exchange of particles or charges between the two molecules. And it requires some wave function overlap because this is a tunneling process. And because it is a tunneling, then the probability would decay exponentially with the distance between the two molecules. So to sum up this brief description of energy transfer mechanisms, this is taken from a paper which unfortunately I forgot where I got it from, so I can't bring here the citation, but it's from biology. So you will see here, this is the constant trivial transfer rate, so which is simply the emission rate, which is our reference. We see the forester that is decaying is R to the 6, and here is the Dexter rate. One of the things that you might notice that it could be that at very short distances, the Dexter transfer rate would be preferable over the forester transfer rate. So for highly packed molecules, it could be that even singlets would prefer to go for the Dexter transfer rate. The forester energy transfer mechanism is very popular, not for its beauty, but more because it's abundant and it appears in many different systems. And as we've seen, it is very powerful to describe the energy transferred from a single donor to a single acceptor. And we should ask ourselves in the context of these lectures, do we expect to see this kind of transfer in organic electronics? Are we going to make use of this one? Is it going to be useful for any application? And of course, I'm not going to answer that. We'll understand or learn these answers as we continue along. So what we've seen so far about the excitons is that they are neutral, and we've seen some classifications, and we also have seen that they can move and how they can move. So we have really covered this this paragraph. In short, organic classifications, then we've seen the inorganic classification of tight and expanded exciton. We then looked at intra and interchain excitons. And lastly, we've classified them as a function of their respective spins. Then we looked at three transfer mechanisms. We saw the trivial one, which involves photon emission and absorption. The Forster energy transfer, which is a dipole-dipole interaction in the near field. And lastly, the Dexter exchange mechanism.